behalf of the Directorate of Film Festivals and the Entertainment Society of Goa, I welcome you to the 46th International Film Festival of India. And we are ready for the Masterclass on direction by Rakeysh, Omprakash, Mehra. Before we go ahead, we have a collection of trailers which will be on screen, and then we'll get back after that.
पढ़ाया आपने? मैं पाकिस्तान नहीं जाऊंगा।
सर मेरे से नहीं होना। मेरे पैर नहीं उठने सर।
वो सब तो दुरुस्त है जनाब। पर मिल्खा सिंह है किधर?
तेरे नाल कोई साढ़े निके निके बच्चे होंगे बहुत सारे महिंदर परमिंदर जसविंदर धर्मिंदर रजिंदर क्या देख रहे साले स्मार्ट सुधार जी
इंडिया का कोर्ट पाना है
ओए नहीं नहीं मिलता इंडिया का कोर्ट कमाना पड़ता है मेहनत करनी पड़ती है दौड़ना पड़ता है उसके लिए
की जिंदगी की आखिरी रेस साबित हो सकती है
दौड़ूंगा भी वैसे ही
Take it.
Saw has won 8 national awards and also a BAFTA nomination for the best foreign language film. And now I'd like to see all of you put your hands together and welcome Rakeysh, Omprakash, Mehra on stage. When did we become like 100 years cinema? 2013. Okay, great. Yeah. So around 2013, I think I was going into the shoot of Baat Mil Kabab, which was like 4 months away. And my good friend Shekhar Kapoor, he said we are going to get 100 years old and so let's do something. I said, I'm making a movie. He said, no, let's do something else. I said, Shekhar, I'm making a movie. 4 months, I'm going into the sets. He said, yeah, so why not do something? I said, this guy is crazy. He said, listen, it's 100 years and every day we don't become 100 years. So I said, then you do something because I'm shooting a movie. He said, no, you know, I've been out for so long, I think you should do something. So, thank you.
Hello?
Yeah, better? So, I said, fine. So I pushed my shoot by 2 months. And I said, we need some money. So we called up another friend of ours, Ronnie Screwala. And we said, we are getting 100 years old, so give us some money. So he said, great, but why should I? I said, you made a lot of money from movies, so you might as well give us some loose change. He said, fine, I've got just 1 crore rupees, do anything. And you and Shekhar don't come back to me for more money. He said, fine, thank you. So we had some money. And he said, now what to do? So I looked at Shekhar and he had vanished. He was giving a Twitter from somewhere in Milan and all. I said, okay. So I was left alone with 1 crore rupees and I said, okay, what to do? So, you know this term Bollywood, it always just still irks me a lot. This whole thing we are stuck with. So I said, okay, let's do like a documentary called Bollywood, the Greatest Love Story Ever Told. And let's have fun. So I took a small camera, went into VT station, put the camera on, came out, and there are all these cabs, you know, VT station, if you've been to Bombay, all these cabs standing outside, a line of cabs. So I went to the first taxi and I said, Bhaiya, Bollywood chaloge? So he looked at me. He said, no, sir. You know? I went to the other one and I said, Bhaiya, Bollywood chalenge? Koi Bollywood nahi hai aapke. And he went back to his phone. Went to the third one, fourth one, and they all had a blank expression about them. Then went to this pan chewing chacha and said, Chacha, Bollywood le chalo please. Haan, betho, bilkul. I said, wow, this guy knows where Bollywood is. So I said, kitna paisa lagega? Zyada nahi, 400 rupya lagega. I said, okay, that's, chaliye, 400 rupya mein Bollywood dekhne ko milega. So I sat in the cab, he took me around Haji Ali, this thing, Bandra, pass, we reached Juhu, took me in front of Amitabh Bachchan's house, said, aa gaya Bollywood. I said, okay, great. So I messaged Amitji. I said, are you in? And as luck would have it, he was there. So I went into his house. I said, so you are Mr. Bollywood. He says, don't even say that, I hate the job. I said, precisely, the cab driver just dropped me here. So the journey started, and as to what was, I was to find out this whole journey of Indian cinema through this documentary and where we've landed ourselves today. Started, put together a small team, young boys and girls, interns, and we collected over 260 odd movies. We went to Film Division, thank you very much, you are there, and he helped me with so much of footage of whatever the milestones in Indian history, the social economic milestones which have had an indelible mark in the making of this country or otherwise, right from when the Britishers left. So I said we should start from a point. So we took 1947, the British flag going down, Indian flag coming up, and Jawaharlal Nehru's speech, the midnight speech. From there on, and I started putting the films together as per his milestones, and came up to 2010 or 2000, whatever, the movies I was getting. There were a lot many films, 260, so we decided let's bring the number down, so we chart ke 200 bacha. Aur chata, kuch, phir bhi 150 films are left. 150 films, all this footage I've got from Films Division, and I should keep looking at it. Day and night, there was a lot of things, a lot of movies to watch, a lot of footage to watch, but it was fascinating, absolutely fascinating to see what was going on. And slowly this pattern started developing that somewhere, and we say it quite often and we talk about it quite often, but I saw it happening that movies were juxtaposing, reflecting, opposing, commenting on the socio-political economic changes in the country in its own way, even confiding with them, even following them, even agreeing with the changes, even putting blinkers to the changes, in the sense not recognizing all this is going on. So when we got independence, there was this huge thing, nation is born, there was hope. So ye desh hai veer jawano ka, dilon ka, mastanon ka, saath hi haath badhana rahe. The cinema of hope, great cinema, do aankhe bara haath, Berlin mein, Golden Lion, everything is happening. People are talking about Indian cinema. And soon the 5-year plan started failing. There was a Maharashtra drought. There was a Bengal famine leading to China war, and we got a drubbing in the China war. And Chinese just came in, they slapped us and they walked out. Two wars, partition, bloody partition, absolutely millions displaced, homeless, women and children suffered. All that honeymoon with independence was soon over. And we gave birth to a hero in Kala Bazaar, a protagonist who was selling tickets in black. And Devanand emerged as in Jal and something where even a thief could be a hero. Before that, all your heroes and heroines are very idle. They were copybook. They were your teachers. And we heard a sound saying, Jine naaz hai hin par wo kahan hai, kahan hai, kahan hai. My knowledge, I must apologize, during this work of documentary, I restricted myself to Hindi cinema because the time was less. Otherwise, I had told Shekhar and Ronnie, give me 5 years and let me do a whole thing about what's going on. And it will take me 5 years, maybe 7, maybe 10, but Hindi cinema, because I had grown up with it, was a staple diet with me, so I knew a little bit about it and I could jump into it. So, ye duniya agar mil bhi jaye to kya hai? Heart-wrenching pictures of Bengal famine. Thank you, Eddie. Nation in chaos, total. Joblessness. And Devdas became like an icon. Kaun peeta hai, kehta hai, sharab hum peete hai, botal hume peeti hai types. Everybody had a struggle. Everybody wanted to die of cancer or some liver failure. And the youngsters, that was their idol at that point of time. They all wanted to be Devdas. They all wanted to escape the harsh reality of life. Because outside there was no life. There was no electricity, there were no jobs. Ki matlab, I had written something there which got thrown out. Ki, bulb hai to electricity nahi hai, null hai to paani nahi hai. So स्कूल है तो किताबें नहीं है, किताबें है तो टीचर गायब, एग्जाम होते हैं तो पेपर निकल आते हैं, फिर टीचर मिलता है तो हड़ताल हो जाती है, पास भी हो गए तो मतलब कॉलेज में एडमिशन नहीं मिलता, मिलता है तो डिग्री नहीं मिलती, डिग्री मिलती है नौकरी नहीं मिलती, शादी हो भी जाए तो घर नहीं मिलता, और घर मिलता है तो नल है तो पानी नहीं। इट वॉज अ विशियस सर्कल, नेशन वॉज गोइंग थ्रू डार्क एजेस, एंड सो व्हाट डिड वी डू, वी एस्केप्ड इट, वी इन्वेंटेड एस्केपिज्म, and our hero started dancing for God's sake. And this was a mystery with me. Why do our heroes dance? Because you'd be surprised, before 1962, 63, thereabouts, somewhere there, the hero never danced. So out of the 100 years of cinema, before that, unless you were doing a very folk, lovely kind of a theater, the hero, he might sing, Baisakhi wagaira, but not the way he's dancing today. Why he's dancing up to today is still a mystery with me. That time I understood. And we gave birth to Shami uncle, Shami Kapoor. And Shami Kapoor started dancing he was jumping off a helicopter onto the snow, into the water. He was doing all sorts of crazy things. And all the other heroes thereafter started emulating him. And we gave birth to escapism, and we would go to cinema to escape life, to escape the harsh realities of life. And this was for a very long time we lived in what we were known as a third world. So imagine, it was a third world. Like my first, not so important, but first pair of jeans, denims I acquired was in behind Lal Killa, there used to be a Sunday market, the Chor Bazaar, for some 10 rupees, which was worn out, second hand, third hand, but I had my pair of denim. So that's how you got to feel ki, when you saw some Western film, they used to wear denims. So the movies kept escaping, and then Mehngai Maar Gayi and those kind of films happened. And then we gave birth to another hero who challenged the system, who became anti-establishment. So far we've been taught you have to be a good guy. You have to be an honest person. You have to grow up or mehnat ki roti and all that. Like Satya Kaam did and films like that. And all the protagonists were like good guys. But here, we started idealizing protagonists who was a smuggler, who worked for a smuggler. And we gave birth to Amitabh Bachchan. And like how? We made him into an icon. Because he went entire the system in his own way. And he took shortcuts, which was okay by us, as such. And cinema also, for the next 20 years, generally speaking, went through dark ages like the country went. It was confusion. There was no voice in cinema. Yes, there came revival in bits and pieces. There were voices. There has to be. When Govind and Shyam and all, when they started making films, and Girish. So, but more or less, we were confined to this potpourri of a thali where you would get everything. So in terms of storytelling, it was a khichdi, like you would have, and at the end you would have a sweet dish also. So you knew the story. Boy meet girls, girl meet boy, they meet each other, they fall in love, then the girl is taken away by the villain, then he chases him, he does some dishum, gets her back, and a little more complex, you would add some uncles and aunties and so on and so forth, and make it like that. There was utter confusion in the country, but then, and we kept seeing the documentary footage, how it was going with us. And then something strange happened. We saw Mandal Commission. Before that, Indira Gandhi's assassination, Rajiv Gandhi's assassination, all that. So Mujibur-Rahman, all that was happening. More war with 71 war, again wars with Pakistan were going on, all this hatred and stuff like that. But still, the Cold War between the US and Russia, and how India was a non-aligned country, but aligned, but actually non-aligned. So there was no stand. We didn't take a stand. We didn't have the balls to take a stand. How would we make movies with a stand? How could we tell stories? But then the economy opened. There's a famous UN speech, I Have a Dream. And cinema started also opening a bit, not immediately. There was no wave as such. And then economy opened a little more, cinema opened a little more. And then the connectivity happened. And suddenly Indians got connected to the world. You have to believe the era before connectivity. I said, you didn't know what was going on. You really didn't know. Believe me, you didn't know what was going on. And the only thing you knew was what was fed to you. So what BBC or All India Radio or Doordarshan or some other channel decided to tell you, choose to tell you, you thought, why hai? Except sports, because there you saw results. So anyway, things started happening and we started coming out of the shell. And we're living in a great time right now because it's a time of great churning, outside and within. And time for expression, time to tell stories. And we can see that happening, we can see that mushrooming. My endeavor has always been to take the popular platform and try and tell a story to the masses, not to the niches. Try and take cinema there. And try, it's a difficult road. It was always when I make the film, it's always you're neither here or there. You're not selecting a site. So in terms of, so the producers are always at the edge, whether this one is gonna work or not, because you're spending so much money. And you are always at the edge, whether what you're thinking is gonna go across or not. So where do the stories come from? I think for me, I can't speak for everybody else, have always come from life, from my life and what has enriched me. So I'm from Old Delhi. We always slept on the terrace, except winters and rain. So with my nani and all the cousins, and every night nani used to tell us a story. We used to call her Inni. Inni used to tell us a story about Ramayana every day. And Mahabharata. Every day the same story about Ram and Ravan, about good and evil, fight of good over evil, and how good will always win in our own way. And she had many interpretations. And just before half of us had slept, half were wide awake, half were counting the stars, she would spoil it for us. She would say, "Asal mein wo Ram Ravan kuch nahi hai, wo dono same hai, wo tumhare andar." She would say, "What is she saying? Yaar, itna kahani bataya. Aaj to Ram Ravan alag hona chahiye tha. Aaj bhi wo same hai." So he said, "You are Ram and you are Ravan. These are actually stories. These are very good characters." And she never got it religious. She always said the writer. She always picked up Valmiki. She always said the characters created. And she said it's very well done because he's taken the good and the evil, but actually they're both inside you. You have to make choices. So I ended up making ups, trying to find out what Nani was saying, what my granny was saying. Where it was a philosophy. And both Amitav and Manoj would tell me, "Are you sure? Are you sure?" Because they were more experienced. And it was my first film. And how to get philosophy onto cinema
You can get plot points, you can get characters. But how to... I said, no, we'll try and do it. So the good guy kills the bad guy's soul, bad soul moves into the body of the good guy. Now the good guy has got a bad guy inside. Or the bad guy has a perfect address. He's in the body of a good guy, who's also high up in the intelligence. And the bad guy was an assassin, so now he has a clear shot at everybody. Stuff like that. It was a simplistic way of looking at it. And there was my attachment to song and dance, so I had great fun doing that, got it out of my system. And being the first film, I realized, okay, fine, this was, thank you, Nani. Cinema is much more than my grandmother's stories, and maybe. So what is it? And I was also doing advertising, which used to take me to London a lot, and I used to edit there. And we were just breaking into blue screen, green screen, VFX. The word VFX was introduced to us first time. And Ad Films gave me the opportunity to have bigger budgets to do those kind of magical things. And because the economy was opening, we started getting big budgets also, so which I started experimenting with the media. Roaming around in London, I saw this HMV and Virgin, and I went into the basement, and there was a full wall out there of which they called World Cinema. So I used to keep going there and collecting the VHS and then putting it back, because there were £9.99 and all. And the Indian mind would straight away start calculating, you know, £20 into this much, into this much. Itna yaar, leon ke nahi lo. So leke phir airport jaate jaate bhaag ke ek khareed ke, and used to watch. And suddenly I discovered Kurosawa, I discovered Fellini. And because I discovered these two gentlemen first, they had a huge impact. Before that, I had not even heard the name. I could not even pronounce it. And then I started discovering a lot more. And then after that, I didn't see the price. I would go there and like a greedy pig, pick up as much. And at the same time, started writing a story called Young Guns of India with Kamlesh Pandey. This was about the armed revolution of India, 1919 to 1933. Bhagat Singh started with Kartar Singh Sarawa, a 19-year-old kid who blew a bomb, got hanged, went to Bhagat Singh, Rajguru, Sukhdev, Chandrasekhar Azad, and Ram Prasad Bismillah, Ashraf Ullah Khan. Then Chandrasekhar Azad became the man. Fascinating, these young guys, the more I researched, Kamlesh Pandey was writing it, the more fascinating it became. Once they were hungry as if they were running away, for 6 months they were underground, and they were very hungry. They hadn't eaten for 4 or 5 days, and they were hiding in a brick kiln. And 2 days later or 3 days later, Chandrasekhar Azad showed up with some coins, you know, 1 rupee, 2 rupee. Like that, in coins. And they were so hungry that they were actually doing a mock lunch out there. So in the mock lunch every day, Sukhdev would serve the favorite things. And they would all pretend they have eaten, then they would go work and sleep. Taj paid, oh, nee, don't give me more. They used to have fun. So all this was sounding very young to my ears. It was sounding like college, it was sounding like Delhi University. They sounded like, these guys are so cool, man. They are making fun of hunger. So Azad came with 2 rupees. They went to Raja Ki Mandi. They were ordering their whatever thing from the halwai. They turned to Bhagat Singh for the money, because Azad gave it to Bhagat Singh. He was most responsible. And Bhagat Singh was running with the money. And they said, no, Bhagat Singh, wait. And they chased him. He jumped over the fence. There's a cinema hall there. It was playing Uncle Tom's Cabin. he went and bought the tickets of the month. So I said, oh, that's wonderful. Hungry for 4 days, but I'd rather see a movie. So the connect was perfect. So we did Young Guns of India. And like this, in a small thing, I narrated the story and the idea to the youngsters of 2003 India. And there were blank expressions. They were getting bored. They started talking to me about Nike, about Levi's, about perfume, about first dates, because you know the youngsters were discovering Marlboro. They were discovering something. And they were also serious among the people who wanted to break through, who wanted to change science, maths, who wanted to invent a spaceship. And they were also, it was happening, they were not interested in the 1920s India. But I was very interested and I had to tell that story. It was not their story, it was my story. So I said, this is not going to happen. We came back and we were like heartbroken, me and Kamlesh Pandey. This was like 4 years of research. And he said, what the hell to do? I said, there's only one solution, which is called a bottle of vodka. So he said, okay, yeah, I don't drink much. I said, no problem. Let's drink today. So, one bottle of vodka, two bottles of vodka, 3 days, third bottle, and we kept thinking what to do. Kamlesh being Kamlesh, he turned the story around on his head, where a British documentary filmmaker comes to India, wanting to make, like I wanted to make, but nobody is interested. But she ends up choosing these five guys. And when they start enacting the story, they feel something shift within them. And that's what the audience got. That's what the young of India got. When they saw the movie, something started shifting. But then I told Kamlesh, it has to be relevant to the generation. So I went and I studied in an Air Force school, Balbharti Air Force School, Lodhi Road, New Delhi. Every day I entered the school, there was a MiG-21 aircraft there on the foil, a MiG-21, big one, without the engine, just the dhancha. Used to play around it, play cricket under it, get punished around it, eat a tiffin there, romance around the MiG. MiG was a part of my life. And we would go to air shows. All my friends were from our Air Force kids. My teachers were wives of wing commanders and all. So somewhere the Air Force was a part of my life and I wanted to join Air Force, wanted to be a fighter pilot and didn't make it beyond the first interview. You got to be good in science and stuff like that. So which was beyond me anyway. So all that happened. So I said, Kamlesh ji, and I saw the documentary on NDTV called The Flying Coffins where the MiGs were crashing. And I started researching. Not much. It took me like all of 12 hours to research it. I started calling up, started finding out, and MiGs were going down. What was going on? Another 2,000 crores corruption scam. And you know how we come across as scams and there's so many, 36,000 crore, 98,000 crores, we read about them. But this one hurt me because my friends were flying MiGs and they were going down. I knew of guys, you know, so I could identify. And I said, what the hell, now I'm a filmmaker, I have to, told company, this is what our midpoint is. The MiG goes down. So while your plot point one was something else, this is what the midpoint, and this, he says the story will turn altogether. I said, let's plant a character much before. So we invented Madhavan's character of a wing commander. Yeah, and we had Sonia romance him, and so he, when it goes down, we feel the guys feel, and they revolt against the system in a similar way. Sahil Lugyanvi ka ek sheer hai, ki bahut dinon se tha, बहुत दिनों से है मशकला सियासत का जब जवां हो बच्चे तो कत्ल हो जाए. So Mandal Commission proved exactly what Sahir wrote 50 years ago. When the students came out on the street, they were beaten, they were shot at. And some of the footage I saw in Connaught Place in TV Today's studio, and they were banned and censored, and CBI came and grabbed everything. But they had made some copies, and I saw actually guys being shot, girls being slapped, they being dragged. So the system came down. It was like Tiananmen Square. So we said, okay, so let's incorporate real life. Let's incorporate the essence, the spirit of Mandal Commission. And all that put together then became Rangirasani as such. You go to Old Delhi, and I don't know how many of us have gone to Old Delhi. It's called Delhi 6 because the pin code ID is 110006. So Delhi 6. Delhi 6. Oh. So up left lete hain, Chandni Chowk pe. So when I turn left, on my left is a bird museum. A bird hospital. It's amazing, huh? Bird hospital. As a child, I've grown up seeing the bird hospital. And there were some crazy birds there. You could go in and kisi ka tongue toota hai, kisi ka ye, but all of them. The red color building. Next to that is the Gauri Shankar Mandir, the great Shiv Mandir, where my mom would go every Monday, so I had to go there. And my job was to look after the slippers. Exactly. Very funny thing happened. So nobody should pick up the slippers. While she would do a friendship with Shiv and God and all, come out, I had the slippers intact. Opposite that is the church, the Methodist church. Next to it is the Financial Bank of India, that time State Bank of India. Diagonally opposite is Sish Ganj Gurdwara. Just before that is McDonald's, and next to that, close to that is Haldiram, the great Indian sweets and namkeen and pani puri, Golgappe. Bang ahead is apna Fatehpur Masjid, Fatehpuri Masjid, and then you turn around, and what you see is the Indian flag. So that was a microcosm of India for me. Everything was there in Old Delhi, including population. It's like crazy. It's like people are, you know, there's a tap somewhere and people are coming out of tap. And somebody has forgotten to put it off. So, abhi tak tapak rahe. So the Chandni Chowk is responsible for the Indian population explosion. Because wahan kahin pe ek nal hai, jahan se log tap tap tap. Aur wo phir chalte chalte, they go into India all over. Something like that. So that was, and growing up in Old Delhi, I encountered this immense fear. I won't call it intolerance, that's an amazing word these days. I want to look into dictionary what it means and what is this going on. Suddenly, so basically I thought insecurity between the Hindus and the Muslims. We all live together. I love to go to Karim's and eat. I lived in Charkhe Walo. Opposite me was Gali Qasim, where there is Ghalib's Mazar. And playing hide and seek, we used to hide behind the Mazar, all that. Nobody knew. Indian Archaeological Department had no clue that Ghalib is buried here. But we were there. Yeah. And so we've grown up in all that, but at the drop of a hat, the Fataks would close, the Gali's would go sunsan. People would collect bottles and patthar and stuff like that, you know, ki problem hai Hindu Muslim ka. So, and then one of our great politicians decided to break a masjid. So we took in Babri Masjid. So I took that as a plot and said, we'll place it here, that there is a masjid, but 416 years ago precisely, they invented. There used to be a Hanuman temple and all that. So the whole story kind of unfolded within that. Again, trying to get a philosophy into cinema to say, because first time, Ux really didn't work at the box office. I said, एक हिट बन गई ना रंग दे बसंती, लेट्स ट्राई अगेन। अब कुत्ते की पूछ तो ऐसी होती। सो ट्राइड अगेन कि ये काला बंदर हमारे अंदर है, अगेन इट डिडंट गो अक्रॉस टू द पीपल, अंदर इट मेड मोर मनी देन अस। We barely crossed the line after selling satellite and all. But now, fortunately, it's selling every week to all TV stations all over the world. So we started making money around 8 years later or 6 years later. But anyway, it didn't happen. And then we made Bhaag Milka Bhaag, which is because from Old Delhi I shifted to Lajpat Nagar, which was a refugee colony. Every day our neighbors used to tell us stories about the partition of India and how bad Pakistan is. You know, Pakistan is really bad. And you know, their flag is so bad and all that. So they have grown up with that, yeah, with that hatred. Like they're so bad. But I wouldn't believe those uncles. And then 1984 riots happened and Hindus were killing Sikhs. So I said, okay. And by this time I was young, I was 21. So I could think on my own and I don't have to believe on uncles and aunties. I said, bullshit. You guys are bullshitting me totally. This is totally wrong. It doesn't matter. We all have tribal mentalities and we need somebody to kill, basically. Kill each other. So Shivites have been killing Vaishnavites, both are Hindu sects, for 4,000 years ago. Then Shias and Sunnis, Catholics and Protestants, and now Hindus and Muslims, and everybody's killing everybody. So it's hatred, it's a basic emotion, and if we don't channelize it in the correct way, it gets expressed. And this guy came and presented me an autobiography of Milkha Singh. He, a young filmmaker, he wanted to make another film. Apparently he'd gone to meet Milkha Singh and got a signed copy. And he said, ye bhi bada achhi story hai. Maine kaha, tu banayega? Nahi, nahi, nahi. Main mereko athletics samajh nahi aata hai. He was making a very good comedy. I started going through the autobiography. It was in Gurmukhi. So I said, thank you. But the pictures were there. And my childhood thing came out again, Milkha Singh, Dara Singh, Dhyan Chand, three sportsmen we idolized. And that's it. And for us, Milkha Singh was a legend, Dara Singh was a legend whom we never saw, you know, when we grew up. So being a sportsman, I used to swim, went up to Asian Games, camp and all that. We were given instances of Milkha Singh a lot in the stadium. I used to play cricket. For my school, we used to practice in National Stadium. So, हम थोड़ा थकते थे, बोलते थे मिल्खा सिंह होता तो 100 राउंड मारता थे। यार मिल्खा सिंह को हर टाइम हमारी लाइफ में क्यों लाते? मतलब उसको मारने तो वो सरदार है यार, सरदार तो करते ही हैं, 100 राउंड मारते हैं। हम थोड़ी हैं सरदार। नहीं वो इतनी मेहनत करते थे, ये करते थे, वो करते थे। तो वो कुछ एंड सम जोक्स डिडंट नो मच अबाउट हिम। सो आई कॉल्ड अप लोकेश, गुड फ्रेंड ऑफ माइन, हू'ड रिटन दिस बुक ऑफ स्पोर्ट्स, also responsible for IPL in India, in a small way. I said, do you know Milkha Singh? He said, yeah, of course. He's been a sports journalist for long, especially athletics. And he called up Jeev and he said, my friend makes movies, he made Rande Basanti, he wants to meet Milkha Singh. So I went to Chandigarh and I met Milkha sir and it was a great meeting and we even had beer during lunch. And we kept talking. And my flight was back at 5:30 and I decided to cancel it. And checked into a hotel, bought myself toothpaste and toothbrush, and went to 19th sector, bought some pajamas and all from Khadi Bhavan, and stayed over in Chandigarh for the next 5 days. And kept speaking, listening to Milkha sir. And Milkha sir revived what I had heard in Lajpat Nagar, the stories of partition. And throughout, there's a long story to tell. He's a great storyteller. Well, I could have made a better film, which if I'd have just switched on the camera and switched it off and played it for all of you, could have been 100 times better film because he's such a good storyteller. I can't match it. Twice I noticed there were tears in his eyes. once, and he broke down talking about the massacre of his family. Mother, father, sister, brother, sisters, brothers, sister-in-laws, cousins, all killed during the partition. And he had this hatred of Pakistan inside him. And when Nehru asked him to go and run there, he refused, the Prime Minister of India. Second time when tears emerged in his eyes, when he dropped, he was a world champion, he had the world record, Rome Olympics, was the gold medal was in his pocket, he was a favorite, he was leading the race up to 200 meters, and he looked back, saying, how far am I running too fast, should I conserve my energy? Tactical error, and everybody overtook him in the blink of the eye, and he came fourth, still breaking the world record. It's a historic race because all four broke the world record in that race. But he cried because that was the Olympic medal. It meant a lot. But at a time when India had nothing, escapism was going on, he gave a hero to the world. So I had to tell the story. And partition meant a lot to me, always. To my generation, because we didn't witness partition, but our parents immediately witnessed partition. Being from Delhi, our uncles and aunts immediately knew about it. They were young at that time. They were part of it. So millions of people, while the country was celebrating independence, millions were also suffering partition, especially the people who suffer are the women and the children. Whether it was the apartheid, whether it was Bronx, whether it was anything, anywhere in the world, all these things always affect the women and the children, and Milkha Singh was one of them. So that was a story to tell, how a 12-year-old who loses everything, doesn't have shoes to wear, food to eat, anything, refugee camp, how he breaks the world record. And that was the story to tell, and we told that story, and finally I cheated. Because he went to Lahore, he came back, he went to Rome Olympics. But in my story, I wrote the first scene, Rome Olympics. His coach shouts, Bhag Milkha Bhag. He looks back and he sees a tortured childhood. He sees his father's massacre. And at that point, he loses the race. He imagines all that. Cinema, you can imagine. What's going on in your head, you really don't know. So we have that thing to play with. And the last thing is when he goes to Lahore, which was actually incorrect, but I took his permission, and he said, yeah, this is good. And when he wins the race, he looks, and his childhood is smiling at him. So from a tortured childhood to a smiling childhood. So the demons which he was running away from had being forgiven. But Milkha Singh hadn't forgiven the demons for the last 60 years. So when he saw the film like this, I remember it was Milkha Singh, Paran on one side, myself on the other side, three of us watching the film. After, between the film, in somewhere he held my hand and he was crying, and nobody can express what he would have felt. Imagine a film on you and you're watching it. It's crazy. Nobody can tell you what he felt like. I've been asked that question a lot of times. How can I tell? It's seeing yourself, your out-of-body kind of experience. So, but he said, you know what? I had so much hatred for, and today it has melted, which was fantastic. I thought.